My personal exploration around Aboriginal history and my own identity as an Australian has led me to a document I remember seeing as a child. At the time, I didn't understand it. It just looked like a recipe, but about people. My search of this document has led me to the National Library of Australia, to a man named Orba Octavius Neville, the man responsible for the Stolen Generations. I'm Sir Peppy, and welcome to Room A7. So I'm making my way down to the National Library of Australia in the ACT, and I've done as much research as I possibly could on my own, but I need to find primary sources. One of the primary sources I'm looking for is information on A.O. Neville and his ideas on absorption and the absorption policy. Now, the amazing thing about the absorption policy in the 1930s, was that it wasn't about assimilation. The absorption policy was, in short, to breed out the Aboriginal people. Now, absorption, what that really boils down to is you take a half-caste and then you take them away from the family. You bring them up as an Australian in a white family, and then you get them to marry someone who is white. Then you have a quarter caste, or whatever the fraction is, and then you continue that cycle until the black breed basically has been bred out.
Notice, if you will, the half-caste child, and there are ever-increasing numbers of them. Now, what is to happen to them? Are we to allow the creation of an unwanted third race? Should the coloureds be encouraged to go back to the black? Or should they be advanced to white status and be absorbed in the white population? Now, time and again, I am asked by some white man, if I marry this coloured person, will our children be black? Here is the answer. Three generations. Half-blood grandmother, quadroon daughter, octoroon grandson. Now, as you can see, in the third generation, or third cross, no trace of native origin is apparent. The continuing infiltration of white blood finally stamps out the black color. The Aboriginal has simply been bred out.
The absorption policy led to not only assimilation, but the stolen generation, the systematic removal of half-caste kids from Aboriginal settlements and Aboriginal families. And then you took them away from their land, their families, you took away their names, you gave them Christian names, and then eventually they would have no idea of who they are, their background, their culture.
Meet the white face of a new black race, the political Aborigine.
Andrew Bolt listed a number of people who have, he said, chosen to identify themselves as Aboriginal when their lighter skin colour, indicating a mixed heritage, meant they had other choices open to them.
I certainly don't accuse them of opportunism, even if full-blood Aborigines may wonder how such fair people can claim to be one of them and take black jobs.
Mr. Archibald, who describes himself as part Aboriginal, has also labelled the Stolen Generations a concocted myth. He says he stands by all of the comments, but declined a request to be interviewed.
But a lot of people are actually identifying as Aboriginal because they have been able to figure out that their ancestry came from there, that they were part of the Stolen Generation. They are the result of a near genocide. So I just finished my time at the National Library. I wasn't really allowed to film in there, but I found some documents that would help me with my research, but there's some books that I can't access until tomorrow, so I have to come back tomorrow evening so I could actually see if I find what I'm looking for. So since I have to come back tomorrow for the two books on A.O. Neville, I figured, since I'm only a stone throws away from the Aboriginal Tent Embassy, I thought I'd just visit it. I've never been. I've lived in the Canberra region for 7 years. I've never been. So behind me is Old Parliament House, and the politicians don't meet there anymore here in Canberra, but this is the site where it all started, where two Aboriginal men put down a beach umbrella and claimed that it was their embassy, and they parked it right here outside Old Parliament House. And behind me is the site today. The fact that they actually called it a tent embassy really hit home just how marginalized and how different the Aboriginal people were treated in our laws, in our systems, and in our culture. The fact that I'm coming to terms with this now is actually kind of sad. So, I just left one of the tents here on the gardens of Old Parliament House, and I just wanted to make sure that I paid my respects and asked for permission to film in the area. The fact that this embassy is still here after several decades, that truly is amazing. The amount of protests that came through here, I'm surprised it's still standing at all.
Face an uphill battle with these people, especially the bush natives, who have to be protected against themselves. If they would only understand what we are trying to do for them.